We welcome you today to King Street Church. As we worship together, we pray that you will feel God's presence. If you're visiting us for the first time, we invite you to visit a lobby welcome center to learn about our ministries for you and your family and to receive a gift.
Today, you'll find a Connect card in the worship folder. It's designed to be used by anyone in our congregation for a variety of reasons. If you're a guest with us today, we invite you to use this card to connect with our staff. You can also update your address, sign up to volunteer, or request more information about King Street Church. There's even a spot to share a praise or prayer request.
Grief Share is a support group for people grieving the loss of a loved one. A new session is starting on Wednesday, February 1st at 7 p.m. in room M4. Meet people who understand what you're going through and can offer the support you need.
On Friday, February 10th, King Street Church is hosting Night to Shine, sponsored by the Tim Tebow Foundation. This celebration is reserved for people with special needs, and it's a chance for us to make them feel loved and valued. If you would like to participate in Night to Shine or volunteer to help, pick up an information packet from our information walls or visit kingstreetchurch.com/night-to-shine.
King Street Church is celebrating our theme of transformation with an art show. Everyone in the church is invited to participate. You don't have to be a professional artist. We welcome a wide variety of styles. Just use your creativity to illustrate some aspect of transformation. The show will be right here in the hallways of the church from March 3rd through 26th. Register now at kingstreetchurch.com/artshow or in the lobbies on February 12th and 19th.
Well, good morning. Welcome to King Street. It's great to be here this morning to worship the Lord together, to gather to proclaim the goodness of our Lord and to encourage one another. This is a good place to be. Thank you for coming. And we would love to connect to you, those who have been here for some time and those who are brand new to the church. And so we encourage you to find that connect card that's in the worship folder and look at the information there, fill it out. Sign up for classes, check out Sunday school classes and Bible studies and ways in which to serve here at the church. We would love to connect you. Invite you to stand and let's greet one another at this time. Let's sing together.
Oh Lord my God, when I am lost and wandering, consider all the words thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display.
Great is our God. King David said in Psalm 145, I will extol you, my God and King. I will praise you every day. I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. That needs to be stated today. For great is our God and most worthy of our praise. He gave his all in his son, Jesus Christ, for us. And so we are welcomed into that truth, as King David said it best. And I'm going to ask you and invite you to say this statement of what we think about God. And just lead us in this statement, this profession of God and his greatness. So let's say this together. God, the great creator of all things, upholds, directs, disposes and governs all creatures, actions, and things, from the greatest even to the least. He exercises this most wise and holy providence according to his infallible foreknowledge and the free and unchangeable counsel of his own will, to the praise of the glory of his wisdom, power, justice, goodness, and mercy. You see, there is no word too big for our God. There are not enough words to describe his goodness, his grace, his love, his mercy. He's infallible. That's what infallible means. It never ends. There's no way to tell of his truth, but yet we try. And so today we try again. And that's why we were singing, How Great Thou Art. How great is our God. And so let's continue to offer our praise, because our God is awesome.
None like you.
time. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. You may be seated. As Bill continues to play, I just want to ask you just to bow your heads and just continue to focus on the truth we were singing about our God. And then Mitch is going to lead us in prayer before we go into our offering. So let's just take a moment to just pause and reflect on our God.
Gathered here today in full awareness of your greatness. And God, we're grateful that you allow us to gather. God, in your rightful place, you are high and holy and powerful and have all authority among us, us sinners. So God, we ask today for your forgiveness. God, whatever we drug in here that is not of you, Lord, help us to lay it at the foot of the cross today through the songs that we sing, through encountering you in the Word of God. Help us, Lord, as a gathered church body to grow near you. To grow more in your likeness. God, as we give today, help us to give not based off, God, how much we have, but God, help us to give because we want to, because we want to bless you. God, we want to bless the holy name of Jesus. God, that when we sing it, there's power. There's great power to heal and to convict. God, to bring joy. So we ask, Lord, as we give today, as an act of worship, Father, would you use our gifts to engage and bless our community, our church, God, with your gospel. God, as we live your call today in worshiping you and singing to you and singing of who you are, we ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We're going to sing a new song today. Some of you might know it. It's called Lion and the Lamb. I invite you to sing as you catch on.
Thank you.
Just stand with us as we sing, "Who Can Stop the Lord Almighty?"
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the
Whatever you're going through, church, you can sing that.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
He is greater, he's stronger. There's power in the name of Jesus. We say,
who can stop the Lord?
Come on, church, let's sing the Lion and the Lamb, our God.
Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring. The world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
Amen. You may be seated. Our God is a great God. And in his word, we find direction. In his word, we are changed. I invite you to listen to Dr. Tony Evans in preparation to hear God's word and listen to what he has to say about how the word has power to transform. Listen to Dr. Evans.
This is a corner in Baltimore, Maryland, where I was born and raised. This is an environment where I used to preach with my father on the street corners and hand out tracts. While I'm not preaching on street corners as much anymore, I'm still preaching. But this is where the framework was. This is where the foundation was. This is home. Church has been so integral in everything that's happened in our community. We would not be where we are in urban America without the church, because the family is the foundational institution upon which all other institutions are dependent for their ability to function properly. This issue needs to be addressed.
Verse 11 says, I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans I have for you. I know the plans I have for you. Now, why is that important? Because God says, I still have a plan.
The Word of God infiltrated my life through the influence of my dad and my family, and it changed my direction and my destiny. And what it could do for me and did for me, it can do for those who are still caught, locked up and locked in, locked out. If it could change me and my circumstance, then it can transform the circumstances of those who grew up in this city and cities like it all around America. And that's why I'm still preaching the word today, because I was transformed by it, and I'm loving God using me to see it transform the lives of others.
Amen. Well, I invite you to look at Isaiah 55, 10 and 11. Just study it with me, and I'll read it, and you listen and look at it. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven, do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater. So it is. My word that goes out from my mouth, it will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Will you please pray with me? Oh God, perhaps today we'll change our direction and we'll determine our destiny. Help us to hear from you, oh God, from your Spirit, and may your Spirit be upon Pastor Jody as he brings your word, and may we be changed in your likeness, Jesus, in your name, amen.
Amen. Turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians chapter 2. I want to begin here today. I have been working with this passage in preparing for this message this week, and I want to kind of go deep into some of the nuts and bolts, if you will, that we read here. Ephesians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, I'm just going to read to begin with verses 1 through 3. Because in verses 1 through 3, we have a description of a problem that we all have. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world. The ways of this world are leading us down a path, as we'll see in a moment, of judgment. Not only the ways of this world, but the ruler of the kingdom of the air. We know that's Satan himself. He is the prince of this of the air, of this world, of this earth, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient, the spirit who is at work in those who are disobedient. All of us used to live among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts, like the rest. We were by nature deserving of wrath, like the rest, like everyone, all human beings. We were or are, depending on where we're at in our relationship with God, nature. We are by nature deserving of the wrath of God. There's a lot going on there. There is a significant problem that Ephesians 2, 1 through 3 identifies. It's a problem that, quite honestly, we're not going to come to Christ. We're not going to receive the gospel and understand the gospel unless we understand the bad news. Unless we understand the reality that we are, like all people, are or were by nature deserving the wrath of God. We don't understand transformation unless we understand spiritual death, unless we understand the wrath of God that is coming on all those who don't know Him. We don't understand what it means to be spiritually alive unless we truly understand theologically what it means to be spiritually dead, and that we all are or were spiritually dead before we were transformed by the Word of God. So I want to begin today with a really basic foundational question. Who am I then? Who am I? If I am by nature deserving the wrath of God, then I am broken. We're going to look today at three questions. What's the problem? What's the solution? And how do I respond? Or what do I do to fix the problem? And what's the result in my life? So here we go. Who am I? We go all the way back to Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. When we understand the way that humanity was created, then the Lord God formed a man. God created us. We are not here because of evolution. We're not a mistake. We're not here randomly. Each and every one of us are here because we are created by God. God created Adam and Eve, and He knits us together in our mother's womb. God formed a man from the dust of the ground. That is our flesh, our bodies, our bones. The DNA of our physical being is formed from the dust of the ground, and then God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. I love Michelangelo's great picture, painting on the top of the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, where Adam's limp hand is hanging there lifeless, and God's strong hand reaches down and touches Adam's and gives him life, but also breathes into him the breath of life. Now, if I were to go into a medical school and talk about who am I, you know, when we look at this through kind of biological terms, we generally tend to just think of the body, you know, the cranium and the scapula and the fact that we all are humerus. No, wait a minute. That is, we have a humerus, okay? And you know, and a coccyx and a femur. That's who we are, you know, biologically. But I want us to go even deeper than that and give you a little bit of a different diagram that I'm going to work with today. And that is looking at our being. Yes, the fact that we have a body that's part of our outward being, but then deeper, theologically-er, a word. We have the breath of life. God breathed into us the breath of life. But as we look at this through the lens of a few other scriptures, we can see that this breath of life, this inner being, actually has even some more distinction. We read in 1 Thessalonians 5:23 that God himself, this is actually a prayer that Paul prays, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. So what Paul is now looking at is beyond just the physical skeletal. He's looking deeper into this breath of life. Through and through, may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul is praying in the Spirit for our whole being, which includes actually three aspects that we certainly see the body, but it's also the soul and the spirit. The soul and the spirit. So very clearly, three aspects. And let me just add here, I don't think Paul's just throwing out random words there, you know, kind of generally covering a whole lot of aspects. No, he's showing us that when we look at who we are through and through, we are body, soul, and spirit. Now, in Hebrews chapter 4, interestingly, we have another even sharper distinction. For the word of God, we're told, is alive and active. It is sharper than even a two-edged sword, able to penetrate even to the dividing of what? Soul and spirit. Body, soul, and spirit. But according to this verse, there is even a clear distinction or a dividing between the soul and the spirit. This is called theologically a tripartite view of humanity, which I agree with. I honestly think when we look at the words of Scripture, it's hard to avoid this view. That we are body, we are soul, and we are spirit. Now, the Greek actually divides this down into three words as well. When we think of scripturally, it talks about soma, the body. It talks about psyche, the soul. And it talks about pneuma, the spirit. So these are other ways of creating some distinctions between the body, the soul, and the spirit. Now, the soul, there's been a lot of different ways to, okay, then even within that distinction, what does each mean? Well, I believe that the soul, which also then, as I said, is kind of this word psyche, is can be viewed as the mind, the emotions, and the will. This is the level of our being that is, if you will, our personality, our choice, that part of our being that isn't physical, doesn't show up on an X-ray or a CAT scan, but it's very much our being, our identity. It's interesting when you read or hear of a ship that is lost at sea. It doesn't say how many people were lost. What does it say? It says how many souls were lost. How many souls were lost? So that soul is that part of our being, that psyche, that in our culture, we tend to actually kind of talk about it as the heart, that part of our being that is our will, our emotion. In fact, we're told in Luke chapter 10 that we are to love the Lord our God with all of that part of our being, which is our heart, our soul, our mind, and ultimately, yes, all of our strength. But this is our mind, our emotion, our will, our psyche. It's that part of our being. Now, when we talk about, again, who we are, we're going to go back to this problem that we have described in Ephesians chapter 2. That is that we are by nature fallen and deserving God's wrath. So I want to take you back to Genesis, which is when everything went off the rails. The Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die." This is when things became a problem, and it happened in the beginning of Genesis 3. It's called the fall. And what happened was that Adam and Eve and Adam, were given this will, this free will, their own mind and their own emotions, and they could exercise at this level of mind, emotion, and will, at the soul level, they could exercise this choice. But if they did, we are told that they would certainly die. So how did they die? This is, again, kind of digging even a little deeper. How did they die when they made that choice? Did they die physically or did they die spiritually? Now, I'll get to that in a second, but I think it's even more helpful to think about the interaction between these three layers, if you will, of our being. This membrane that exists, this relationship between the body and the soul. When we die physically, what happens? What happens is our soul disconnects from our body, doesn't it? We hear of these reports of, you know, these out-of-body experiences. The body is left there and the soul is dismembered. It comes apart. So as long as the body and the soul are together, what do we have? We have life biologically. Bios. We are physically alive when the soul and the body are together. Well, let me even show you this deeper membrane that exists between the soul and the spirit. This is known as Zoe, or spiritual life. When the Bible describes spiritual life, there is a connection with our spirit and our soul. So again, to this question, how did Adam and Eve die? Well, they did not immediately die physically, did they? God continues to interact with them. What happened was, in the moment of their choice, Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve fell, they died spiritually. They died spiritually. The Spirit of God that lived in their spirits, capital S Spirit of God, dwelling in their human spirit, left. left. It left behind, as Blaise Pascal describes 400 years ago, I think accurately, this God-shaped vacuum inside of each of us. This God-shaped vacuum. It's not our body. It's not our soul. It's our spirit. And Adam and Eve died spiritually in that moment. But I will add this, that their soul was severely damaged. Severely damaged. What do I mean by that? What do we see in Genesis 3 after Adam and Eve sinned and died spiritually? We see that they experienced fear. They hid from God. And what else did they experience? Shame, guilt. So their soul, although not dead, was damaged. And their bodies began the slow process of decay. So they were dead spiritually, damaged emotionally, and decaying physically. That is what each and every one of us are handed as a birthright. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For as in Adam, all die, so in Christ, all will be made alive. So as in Adam, all die, which gets us back to our human nature. We all by nature are born spiritually dead, and as such, deserving of wrath. Let's go back now to Ephesians 3. It's what we read here. You were dead in your transgressions and your sins. Hopefully that means something more to you now than it did 15 minutes ago. That you understand now that to be dead, we are dead spiritually because that interaction between our soul and our spirit doesn't exist anymore outside of Christ in our lives. All of us lived among them. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of the wrath of God. That is our human condition. But we jump down to verse 8. It's actually 2 verse 8, not 5 verse 8. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us, here we go, alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. For it is by grace that you have been saved. So something happens right there at that level of spirit and soul. We are made alive with Christ. How are we made alive with Christ? That is a question we better get clear on, because we are destined to wrath if we don't understand the answer to this question. How are we made alive with Christ? So let's look at it. Verses 6 through 9, chapter 2. Chapter 2. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. Here's the language. In Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. And what I want to say to you is kind of, it's back and forth. It's Christ in us and us in him. That when we have Christ in us, we are then united in him or with him, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us, again, in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved. Saved from what? Saved from the wrath that we all deserve. Saved from the judgment of God coming upon all of those who don't walk with him and aren't in him. For by grace we are saved. Here we go. What's the next word? Through, two words, through faith. And this isn't from you. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that nobody can boast. We cannot ever work our way to spiritual life. We can't. All of the good deeds we might do out here in the body will never unite our spirit with our soul and produce spiritual zoe or spiritual life. It is not by works. Nobody can boast about it. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. How are we made alive with Christ? The answer is one simple word, and it's the word faith. Faith. It is impossible to come to God if we don't believe that He exists and rewards those who earnestly seek after Him. Faith is the opening of our spirits, little s, to His capital S spirit. It's that moment when the Holy Spirit of God fills that vacuum that is our empty spirit with His Holy Spirit. We are in that moment of saving faith, born again. We are given new life. We are adopted into His family. That's what is ours when we believe in Christ. We are given the gift of Zoe, which really makes this verse out of 2 Corinthians 4 come to life. Therefore, we're told by Paul, we do not lose heart. Oh, don't lose heart. Why not? Though outwardly we are wasting away. Outwardly we are wasting away. That's this bios, this connection between our body and our soul. It is deteriorating because of the effects of the fall on this world and our bodies, our beings. But don't lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. When does that happen? That happens when the Spirit of God, by faith, fills our inner being. That we then have Christ in us and we are in Christ. By faith, we are then alive with Christ. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. I want to use some words here, some descriptions out of this book called Victory Over the Darkness by a man named Neil Anderson. I have appreciated this book for about 20 years. Very helpful. Subtitled, Realize the Power of Your Identity in Christ. And in this book, in fact, this graphic, this illustration of the three circles comes out of Neil Anderson's book. But he concludes this part that he's describing who we are with these words. Every temptation is an attempt by the devil to get us to live our lives independently from God. Satan tempts us, just as he did Jesus, by appealing to our most basic and legitimate needs. The question is, are these needs going to be met by the world, the flesh, and the devil, which, by the way, is an unfulfilling way for these needs to be met. This basic vacuum that exists in the human spirit. When we try to meet those needs with the stuff of this world, with alcohol and relationships and pleasure and money and the list goes on. When we try to meet those needs, then we are giving into those are the things that Satan tempts us with. Or are they going to be met by God Himself, who promises to meet all of our needs according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4, verse 19. The most critical needs are the being needs, and they are the ones most wonderfully met in Christ. And he goes on to describe then who we are in Christ. I want you to listen to this. This is our identity when we are in Christ and when Christ dwells by faith in us. I am God's child. I am Christ's friend. I have been justified. I am united with the Lord, and I am one in spirit with Him. I have been bought with a price. I belong to God. I am a member of Christ's body. I am a saint. I have been adopted as God's child. I have direct access to God through the Holy Spirit. I have been redeemed and forgiven of all of my sins. I am complete in Christ. I am free from condemnation. I am assured all things work together for good. I am free from any condemning charges against me. I cannot be separated from the love of God. I have been established, anointed, and sealed by God. I am confident that the good work He began in me will be perfected. I am a citizen of heaven. I am hidden with Christ in God. I have not been given a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. I can find grace and mercy in my time of need. I am born of God, and the evil one cannot touch me. I am the salt and light of the world. I am the branch of the true vine, a channel of His life. I have been chosen and appointed to bear good fruit. I am a personal witness of Christ. I am God's temple. I am a minister of reconciliation for God. I am God's co-worker. I am seated with Christ in the heavenly realm. I am God's workmanship. I may approach God with freedom and confidence, and I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Amen, church? Amen. That's who we are in Christ Jesus. And how do we get this joy, this position, this power, this identity, this zoe, this life? By faith. By faith, we are transformed. And that transformation does not happen at the level of our bios. No, outwardly we are wasting away. It happens at the level of our zoe. Inwardly, we are being renewed every day, for His Spirit fills our spirit and interacts with our soul and fills our mind, and we are then transformed by the renewing of our mind so that we may test and approve God's perfect will and plan for our lives. That is how we are alive spiritually. Amen. Amen. I am no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child of God. Let's bow our heads and our hearts. Lord God, we're going to sing these words. I'm no longer a slave to fear, but I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Lord, that's exactly what happened when Adam and Eve chose sin and chose to turn their backs on You. They became a slave to fear and guilt and shame. But Lord God, by faith and Your work in me, I am no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Lord Jesus, that is our cry today. We, by faith, declare Your glory, Your mercy, Your goodness, Your power, and Your great pursuit of me. Why? God, because You love me. You love us. You've created us, and You love us. And so by faith, Lord Jesus, we cry out to You. Come, fill us by Your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and let's let this be our cry, our declaration.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
Spirit is here. He's moving in this place. Where two or more gather in His name. Jesus said, I am with you. My Spirit is with you. But we also know from Scripture that it is by an act of faith and will that our bodies become that temple of the Spirit. And you may be here right now listening to these words. And you know under heavy conviction that your body, your heart, your spirit is not a temple of God's Spirit. And Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart saying, open your heart. Say yes to me. Say yes, oh God. Say yes, I believe. I believe. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but thanks be to God. Right now, I am found. I was blind, but God, by faith, I see, because I have your Spirit living in me. If God is knocking at the door of your heart right now, open it. Open it. Say, yes, God, come in. Fill me, transform me. I need you, I'm desperate, I'm drowning. God, fill me with your hope. Fill me with your life. Fill me with your spirit. For God, I need you. And I understand I can never work my way to you. I've tried and I've failed. I've stumbled and I've fallen. So Jesus, fill me by your spirit. After the service, as is the case in all of our services now, if you would like to pray with someone and seal that decision, then I would invite you, please come forward up to the piano side or over in the Baker Center, down to stage right, and meet with someone. One of our elders or staff would love to come and just put an arm around you, pray over you, lead you to Christ. I invite you, respond. Say yes. Say yes to God. And now unto him who is able to keep us from stumbling and is able to make us stand in the presence of his glory, blameless and filled with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord. To you, Jesus, be all glory and dominion, majesty and power, today and forevermore. Amen. Hey, church, let's go live the call.